We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
I am happy to join with you today in what will go down in history.
Good morning. You are tuned in to one of the final editions of Faith on the Front Line. Greetings to you, all of you, my brothers and sisters. It has been a joy and a pleasure to host this auspicious and momentous, if you will, broadcast here on LA Talk Live. And I want to bring, I guess, a special message to you, a special edition today, which addresses a matter that's near and dear to my heart, which is kind of part of the reason why this is, just for now, our final edition. We are in a push as a entrepreneur, if you will, that is to say, the founder of a company. I think you'll see the artwork of the logo of our company, the Black Press Audio Digest. And there are times in which in your life, as you step out on faith, you've got to make decisions. You've got to make choices as you take risks. And part of what we want to do is to affirm that and to walk in the midst of that. And I want to hopefully be an encouragement to those of you who may be on the precipice, if you will, on the brink of determining whether you should step out and start your own particular company or business. And I want to encourage you, hopefully through this broadcast. Part of what I want to do is play for you, for your listening inquiry, if you will, or for your listening instruction and hopefully encouragement, a content, a piece of what I do, what I have been encouraged to do. And perhaps after we play a clip of it or a bit of it, I will talk to you about how and why I got into this particular avenue of business and what it's taking. And I hope to engage some of your calls. I'll have a fellow entrepreneur and pastor to come on the line at 11:30, Pastor Wendell Davis of the New Jericho Missionary Baptist Church, and he's also an owner of a particular service that provides a viable ministry to our community, and he's an entrepreneur, he and his lovely wife. So I want to, and kind of in particular, not to be exclusive, but kind of in particular to be sort of emphatic to many of our pastors that as you, of course, serve the church, and you minister in the church, you may also have a particular talent or skill set that you need to explore and perhaps look into monetizing, if you will. I know there are those of you who are entrepreneurs in the sense that you've launched your own ministries and your products and your content, your intellectual content. You've trademarked your brand, and that's wonderful. And I think that that's what you should do, and that is your ministry. Personally, ministry, I feel, is something you're called to, and it's not mine. It's the Spirit of God's ministry. I'm just the instrument in it. But we're led in different ways. So. And that's what we do. So as an entrepreneur, this is the Black Press Audio Digest. And what we do is produce audio versions of various African-American newspapers throughout the country. This one is of the Charlotte Post, which is out of North Carolina. And I'm always appreciative of the fact that these individuals, Gerald Johnson, Linda Johnson, and Brother Herb White, send us their content and allow us to produce an audio version of their particular news content. So, and we're contracting with other papers around the country, African-American newspapers around the country. It's exciting. It's overwhelming at times. And it requires a great deal of sacrifice. I'm just going to play the clip and then maybe come back and talk to you about as what it means to be an entrepreneur. And if you want to call in, the number is 323-473-3100, 323-473-3100. Let's take a listen and we'll be right back.
Diaspora Audio Enterprises presents
the
Black Press Audio Digest, Charlotte Post Edition.
For the week of May 1st through 7th, 2014. In the news.
Church takes state to court for gay rights.
Oh, really? What? Stop it.
Study. HBCU squeezed by NC politics budget.
And JCSU is first HBCU to admit Latino frat.
In sports.
Drive to Thrive. Gastonia's Harold Varner III eyes PGA Tour. And Newton takes ownership of leadership.
In life,
home provides maternal bonds, and AIDS Walk marks 18th anniversary in Charlotte.
In A&E,
LATIVAH, Collard Green Museum, is on a mission, and Dance Company rebrands with new name.
And now, to the news, presented by the magic of Macy's.
Church takes state to court for gay rights.
By Herbert L. White, The Charlotte Post.
A church organization is suing North Carolina for the right to marry same-sex couples. The General Synod of the United Church of Christ, or UCC, filed a lawsuit today in U.S. District Court in Charlotte, contending state law that defines marriage as a union between a man and woman restricts its ministers from performing their religious duties is unconstitutional. North Carolina prohibits couples of the same gender from obtaining a marriage license and makes it a crime for ministers to officiate a marriage ceremony without determining whether a couple has a license. UCC attorneys say the law limits ministers' choices, violates the principles of free exercise of religion, and restricts the freedoms of religion and expressive association guaranteed in the First Amendment. The church seeks a preliminary injunction that would allow ministers the choice of performing a religious marriage. North Carolina voters approved Amendment 1, which limits a domestic legal union to a covenant between a man and a woman in 2012. Under state laws, ministers who perform a marriage for a couple that doesn't have a license can be charged under a Class 1 misdemeanor, punishable by up to 120 days in jail and/or probation and community service. Also, the law allows anyone to sue the minister who performs a marriage ceremony without a license and collect up to $200 if they prevail, which UCC contends applies to a minister performing a religious ceremony not intended to result in a legal marriage. The UCC General Synod adopted a resolution in 2005 that affirms equal marriage rights for couples regardless of gender and declares that government should not interfere with couples regardless of gender who choose to marry and share fully and equally in the rights, responsibilities, and commitment of legally recognized marriage. To read the full story, visit thecharlottepost.com.
The news continues with
Study. HBCU squeezed by NC politics and budget.
By Herbert L. White, The Charlotte Post.
North Carolina's publicly funded black colleges are as underfinanced and undervalued as ever, according to a report by University of Pennsylvania researchers. The study, America's Public HBCUs, a four-state comparison of institutional capacity and state funding priorities, presented a case study of public black colleges in Alabama, Louisiana, Mississippi, and North Carolina. The study called for reforms in state funding and policy to support HBCU's mission of educating underserved students. North Carolina has five public HBCUs: Elizabeth City State, Fayetteville State, North Carolina, AT&T State, North Carolina, Central and Winston-Salem State. Together, they awarded 3,706 degrees to black students in 2011, compared to 2,507 among 11 predominantly white public schools. Underfunding HBCUs compromises their ability to attract students and to compete with more prestigious and well-resourced PWIs, the study's authors wrote. By being routinely shortchanged, many HBCUs cannot compete with other institutions that can afford to offer sleek, ultra-modern facilities. In North Carolina, Governor Pat McCrory, a Republican, hinted last year that underperforming UNC system campuses could be closed or consolidated, which stoked concerns that HBCUs would be shuttered. McCrory also threatened to end ECSU's joint pharmacy program, with UNC Chapel Hill citing dwindling enrollment and inferior education, the report authors wrote. Although McCrory backed off, the message was clear. Flagship institutions overshadow small colleges and universities regardless of the vital purposes they serve.
Diaspora Audio Enterprises.
All right, so I wanted to just share just a clip of the Black Press Audio Digest and give you an idea of exactly the kind of business that we've initiated, a team of amazing individuals who continually support and give their time and talent and have a willingness to learn and cooperate in a way that brings a product of this magnitude with such quality to the fore. So each week we produce a podcast, we are able to prepare it and link it, and we are in the process also being able to link it and distribute it widely. And so in order to do that, sometimes you have to do what you have to do. And I just want to kind of talk with those of you who are fellow entrepreneurs. This station itself is the byproduct of the hard work of entrepreneurs who, like Brother Van, Brother Richard, and Professor, put together their resources, their savvy, their various connections and relationships, and have produced and created LA Talk Live, which is a network that has stepped out into a pioneering area where not many dare to go. It was a risk then, it's a risk now, and they continue to make it happen. And we certainly applaud the owner and all of the managing and staff and all of the various broadcasters who are part of this tremendous effort. And hopefully we'll continue to be a part of it in the near future. I wanted to just kind of touch base on some of the things that's important in entrepreneurship and how you know whether or not it's something that you should do. It's not for everybody, but it's something that you should at least consider, especially in the climate and economic times that we experience within the last, 7-8 years, which has certainly turned a lot of what was taken for granted in terms of the stability of employment in certain corporations and certain businesses capacities and contexts, which is now no longer as certain. You know, working 30 years or 40 years or whatever for a particular corporation or company, and then, you know, retiring with a nice retirement package is oftentimes eludes those of us who are in the work field today, who are in the labor market today. Laws have changed, procedures have changed. I never thought I'd see the day when someone's pension, the pension of hardworking municipal employees, could actually become a bargaining chip or leverage to force current employees to take lower wages and to use that as leverage to work within contracts to lower the expectation of those who want to retire from actually being able to retire with the benefit of a livable financial foundation. I think that the rules have changed, and for those of us who are still in the game, we're going to have to change ourselves and therefore change the game. We have to look at the fact that things are different today. And that means, like our foreparents, we have to take matters into our own hands and allow the creativity within us to be expressed. I think it's nothing new. It's just something that some oftentimes crises and challenges bring us to. And it's nothing to be angry about. It's something, though, I think oftentimes may even wake many of us up from the, the complacency that we oftentimes desire to be more comfortable. But being comfortable is is not really realistic in life, is it? Sometimes it takes unsettling circumstances to wake us up to what we ought to be. And who knows, whatever it is that you develop could at some point be the very thing that not only services those who you care about, but those who you don't even know, who will be inspired, who will be informed, who will be impacted by what you create. And so I think that part of what being an entrepreneur is about is being able to read and assess the time and season in which your life trajectory is taking you. And you have to be aware, conscious of what line of circumstances and issues and conditions that are impacting your well-being. 323-473-3100, an appeal to any of all of those of you who may be listening, who have in fact stepped out on faith and who know what it's like to initiate or organize a congregation, organize and start a particular group or organization or nonprofit or a business, a for-profit business. If you're listening and you want to chime in and give your own testimony, I certainly would love to engage with you in this conversation. We are entrepreneurs on an entrepreneurial adventure here at LA Talk Live, and it's a good forum for us to talk about that and to recognize what it means. So, again, we recognize what's happening. Sometimes a crisis may be an actual a job loss. Like Casey Turner out of Oregon, laid off, could not, having to face her own family crisis, no finances, not the benefit of a partner, and had to make some quick decisions, had to create her own means of subsistence. And so working for that company was no longer an option. Having to kind of discern her environment and see opportunity is extremely critical, because it's one thing to sort of bemoan what you've lost, but oftentimes that loss, if you will, is a push to locate and identify what's in your immediate environment. I'm almost tempted to go biblical on you, to fade to biblical writ. And talk about an African sister who found herself in the midst of the wilderness with her son Ishmael, having been sent away from Abram and his wife Sarah. And in the midst of the wilderness, finds herself abandoned, parched. She feels like she's dying. She's very depressed. She's very upset. And then in her outcry, God hears her and opens her eyes to being able to see a well of water out in the midst of the desert. And I guess in the sense of the truth of the matter is, whether you adhere to or subscribe to the authenticity or correctness of biblical writ, the wisdom within that narrative is the fact that oftentimes within our own environment, close to us, are the answers to the questions that are deeply embedded within us, that cry for validation and some credible action and reaction. Many times the answers for which we moan and have angst, if you will, are right within our environment. Should we choose to reach out through the hurt of the loss, through the disappointment of the diminishing capacity around us, and begin to see other resources, begin to tap into other relationships, and to realize that we have much more going for us than we actually could have ever admitted or known. One thing about grief, or one thing about focusing on loss oftentimes, is that it keeps us in a backward-looking mode, and it limits us to what has happened. And it makes us myopic in that sense. That means near vision. Our vision is too close to us. Our vision is impaired, and therefore we're unable to see into the possibilities because we are fixated and located on what has been lost or what can never be again. So we have to connect ourselves to the possibility that what we have lost is an opportunity and not a deficit. And so that's a part of what it means to read our environment, to read the sign of our experience, and to allow that to be a moment within which, you know, we begin to sort of open our eyes and see differently that there are resources right within our environment. The sister I mentioned in Oregon began to look and see that there were waste products around her, aluminum and other waste products, and began to collect those things and pick them up in pickup truck, and then had to, it was so voluminous, eventually she began to use the resources from recycling and to create her own recycling company. And so someone's trash became her treasure. And so again, we have to look at where we are. It's easy to get discouraged and sense being beat down and frustrated, but it's just as challenging perhaps to see that this is a moment for you to grind and shine. Perhaps if I may move to just one other aspect of what it means to be an entrepreneur, and that is to begin to, once you let go of what it is you can't and haven't or lost or whatever is passing from you, and you begin to get the sense that there's something ahead of you, it's important to begin to really picture in your mind where you want to be, what you see transpiring. If I may, in my own personal space, through some challenges that I experienced that I think have been extremely to my benefit, in the long run, hurtful when it happened, challenging at best, yes, to be sure. And there's always a tendency to want to blame others, to fixate on others. But I've learned how to send folk thank you cards and to appreciate so much what benefit they brought to my life by either some aspect of something that they've done or some choice that they made, and recognize that ultimately the choice is for me to determine how I respond, because that's what I control. Now, maybe that's another part of it. You can't always control what's happened to you, but you have to control what you can control. And you have to capitalize on what you can capitalize on. You have to invent your response in such a way that you are not the victim of the experience, but you become a participant in your own vision as you look forward to and begin to write the vision of where you want to go and what you want to be. You can't allow fear to keep you from moving in that direction. You have to face your fears and face the possibilities that things may or may not go the way you hope that they will go. But I want to assure you of what this one thing: you will never get anywhere being afraid of moving forward. You'll never get anywhere being afraid of letting go of some things and reaching forward to the other things. It's almost like what the Apostle Paul talks about in Philippians 3:13 and 14. He says, I haven't obtained, and I won't act like I've got it going on, or I've, you know, have everything going for me. But this one thing I do know, letting go of those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press. That means I concentrate and I actually compress my my forward intentionality for the press toward the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus. And so there's this sense that I'm headed in a direction. I've got my game face on, I got my A game, and I'm going to make it happen. So the attitude affects everything else in terms of outlook and aptitude and altitude. Aptitude in terms of your acuity and a capacity to begin to make intelligent strategic decisions, even in terms of risks, because some risks are kind of foolish. But you need to make risks based on as much information as you can. And then you got to step out. At some point in time, you just got to go forward. You know, there are several books I'd like to recommend to you if you are thinking of somehow operating in the realm of the entrepreneur, of venturing into a place where you are the initiator and self-starter. And oftentimes, I have to tell you, it is a little lonely, but I'll tell you this. And there may be friends who don't understand what you're doing, and while you're doing it, they may even feel like you're making unnecessary risks and you're endangering your family. But those, you can't expect everyone to understand the mindset and attitude that you have. As an entrepreneur, your mindset is that you're not going to depend on others, that you recognize that it's a benefit to be your own boss, and that you are not going to allow yourself to be limited to other people's choices and decisions as it relates to your own professional career and your own professional possibilities. I want to present to you or suggest to you that you connect into one particular community of entrepreneurs. It's called Entrepreneurs on Fire, EOF, Entrepreneurs on Fire, by John Lee Dumas. Every day he has podcasts posted of entrepreneurs and their experiences in entrepreneurship. He has touched the lives of the major entrepreneurs around the world. He is an authority as a podcaster. He does it pretty much as a living, for a living, and he is on the case as it relates to everything related to podcasting. I believe, Reverend. Good morning.
Good morning. Hey, this is Shannon Eli Braxton. Hey, how are you this morning?
Doing very well, thank you. How are you?
I'm great. Fantastic. Just was able to tune in, so. As every week, I missed the beginning of the conversation, but I know you're talking about entrepreneurship today, and
absolutely.
I wanted to get caught up if it's okay with you.
I hope you will. Absolutely. You're welcome to be a part of this, and I was sharing a couple of the informational sources in reference that might be helpful to entrepreneurs, because entrepreneurs oftentimes feel like they're in rarefied air and they're in a place where nobody else, it almost feels like the Star Trek intro, to go boldly go where no one has gone before. And many times that might be the case, and it might be somewhat daunting or intimidating. But I was sharing with them about the John Lee Dumas's Entrepreneurs on Fire, which is a forum and community of entrepreneurs, and a podcast actually that provides audio and visual information. It's free. You just link on to Entrepreneurs on Fire, and it'll direct you to the podcasts that are printed that are posted every day, and that provides invaluable insight and information into the world of entrepreneurship. Shannon, what's your experience with entrepreneurship?
Well, I'm one of those women who always has a business idea. Ever since I was young, when I thought I was going to do some black market music, my own personal black market music business at the age of 9.
I see.
So now that I'm a little older and a little wiser, I recently went over to the SBA to start getting some tools and some mentorship with starting my own business here in LA. Mm-hmm. So I'm really excited. I wanted to share that. I don't know if you shared that as a resource already, but this workshop I went to, I only went to the orientation and the first workshop, but they also have workshops on acquiring loans. Uh-huh. They have so much information about the different loans you can get, micro lenders, big loans, loans for real estate even, where you can get a business loan and actually live in the place where you're going to operate your business from. Uh-huh. Hmm. So it was a really informational orientation, and I would encourage everyone, it's a free resource, to go to www.sba.gov.
Say it once again, www.sba.gov.
That's right, www.sba.gov.
Wow. Wow, I think that's amazing. And how long have you been in L.A.?
I've been here since February.
I see. Good Lord. Here you are already trying to make it happen, huh?
Hey, God gives us every day, and every day you just got to make the most of it.
So why have you decided, you said at the age of 9 you had those ideas. Where did those ideas come from initially, do you think?
You know, I believe that everybody has everybody has a calling, and a lot of times you can see it in your family legacy. Mm-hmm. And I come from a family of entrepreneurs. My great-grandfather started the Afro-American newspaper.
His wife, my
great-grandmother, was one of the founders of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated. My mom just recently started a wonderful business called Lovely Lavender, where she is making homemade lavender products, and we're going to be selling that in L.A. as well.
Oh, I see. So you'll be a broker out here. Y'all got a little...
I will, yes. We got a family hustle.
We got to watch out for that. Merciful deliverer. Absolutely. And in terms of your specific business, is this what you went to the SBA for, part of that business or your own business?
My business is a organic natural food line.
I see.
So it's going to be when I'm ready to launch. It's something that I, as a personal trainer nutrition consultant, have been looking for on the market for years and years and years, and I haven't been able to find it. So I decided that I wanted to make it for myself and for my family, and I know it's something that other people who are health conscious and those who want to be more health conscious will definitely enjoy.
Fantastic. And how did you actually come to the idea itself?
Well, I just think that being in the kitchen and just saying, this is what I need, finding a need and looking everywhere for something that would meet my nutritional needs. And I hadn't been able to find anything. So it really came out of a need for something that I believe is missing. And that's pretty much all I can say is that, when there's something that this is not available, go ahead on and make it.
Wow. So, and that's the, that's perhaps another word to our entrepreneurs who may be listening to discern a need, locate something that's of importance to you. I guess that is what makes for the passion that is required to pursue this particular idea.
Absolutely. And I know even, I don't know if you've talked about our business yet today, but I know with our business, Diaspora Radio, you'll see that there's nothing like that on the market. And that's something I think that where your passion came from was to meet a need that isn't met.
Absolutely. To provide an audio version of African-American newspapers is something I had never seen. I have never seen before. In fact, I just received the actual documentation from the U.S. Copyright Office yesterday. I was so excited to see that. But it's just interesting that you do have to see what it is that you want and what you think is important, and you'll find that there are others who will find that it is important as well. Look at any business, anywhere you go, and it started with an individual or a group. If you just look far enough into its history, it started with, as you have said, a need. And then it just simply mushroomed from there. What do you plan to, what are your next steps? For those entrepreneurs who are listening, Ms. Shannon, what would you recommend would be their steps after they have, it looks like you're doing your due diligence, you're doing your research, and you're getting the tools, as you say. What would be the next steps for you?
Well, the next step is what I think everybody knows and what we all start to work on. So if you're anything like me, you start to work on it or you look at it and say, all right, I know I got to do that. Okay. So the next step is a business plan.
Let them in. Next step is a business plan?
That's the next step. The next step is a business plan. Actually, before the business plan, the tip that I learned last week at the SBA was that before you even put your time and effort into coming up with your business plan, which does take a lot of time and effort and research.
Sure.
You need to make sure that you know where you're going to get the money from. So I think one thing as, entrepreneurs and people with the entrepreneurial spirit, one thing that we have to do first is just get real with our finances and say, how is it really going to happen? Mm-hmm. And am I qualified to get a loan? Mm-hmm. So before you even waste your time or invest your time. It won't be a waste of your time, but before you invest your time in coming up with a business plan, what was suggested to me and to my class this past Wednesday was that we really get real about how we're going to get our money. Are we going to get a loan? And if we're going to get a loan, are we qualified for a loan? Mm-hmm. And if we're not qualified, it might take some time to get qualified. So mm-hmm. maybe in a year, you'll be ready to mm-hmm. put everything into doing a business plan. Right now, you need to be putting everything into rebuilding your credit.
Absolutely. I think we're joined by another entrepreneur, Reverend Dr. Wendell Davis. Is that you, Reverend?
I'm here, man. How are you?
I appreciate you. Doing very well. Thank you. I was talking about you earlier. You've joined Ms. Shannon Eli Braxton, fellow entrepreneur, and she's launching her thing. And I'm glad to talk with you about what you do. And if you don't mind, Shannon was just talking about how she saw a need in terms of organic food, line of foods. It's how she eats, and therefore that's her consumption diet and choice. And so she's projecting that that's a need that others may have as well, and she's turning that into a business. How did you come to the business that you're doing?
Well, I come to the business that I was doing because I got tired of people working for Caucasians that looked me over for promotion, and I have to train the manager that they decide to promote. And so I was tired of that employment discrimination as an African-American man and being very qualified, equipped, top performer in the workforce, and yet I couldn't get the manager job where I travel in hotels and expense. So I prayed over and said, I'm going to have to get my own business. Some kind of way I got to get in business for myself.
Wow.
And so the thing was looking at what would be my brand, what is the product that's needed.
Right.
And being a pastor in ministry, my thing was counseling in, you know, in graduate school, in counseling. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I got to do something that lines up with ministry still. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So that was counseling. And then going in that field of dealing with hurting people.
Yes.
And seeing the need tremendously.
Uh-oh.
So I got into the substance abuse industry.
Yes,
with counseling, substance abuse, domestic violence. And and that's the direction I went to deal with people, not only that they housing, but also they live in their social needs. Mm-hmm. You know, a person needs a whole holistic care to their situation. Mm-hmm. A person recovering from drugs and alcohol, a person recovering from any type of stress or trauma in their life. All of us are recovering from something.
Yeah.
A bad divorce, a better relationship, or
right.
maybe substance abuse, maybe prescription legal drug abuse.
Right.
And so my thing was to deal with it whole, mm-hmm. their housing, mm-hmm. their counseling, their mm-hmm. social economic, and that would be the direction of the platform that mm-hmm. I went. Mm-hmm. We're doing transitional housing and recovery
mm-hmm.
and counseling and social model issues,
mm-hmm.
which don't make you rich
mm-hmm.
because dealing with, you know, disenfranchised, less advantaged people, and then you're dealing with felons. So this is not anything going to make you rich overnight, but I tell you, it will keep steady employment.
Mm-hmm.
I've managed to be able to keep steady employment and also did to keep 14 people employed over the past 14 years. So
wow.
I was listening as come on the program talking about, you know, a loan. I think the only loan we should get is on mortgage, on real estate.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you get loans, you're automatically going in debt. Even if it's into a business, you're already in debt on your business.
Mm-hmm.
It takes 5 years for a business to even survive or make that curve. So you're automatically going in debt. So I think people should do savings, investigate, and maybe get donations from their family members
mm-hmm.
of what they want to do, because you're going in the hole already.
That's
you're going
right.
in the debt on collateral. It's like burning money up because, it's, you know, some months you can feed yourself, some months you can pay the rent. Then there are many months you can't feed yourself or pay the rent.
You Lord know, you're constantly contemplating
doing a job and doing your business.
Yes, sir.
So if You bring that with a loan you got to pay back and credit and all that in line. Of course, we know to be in business and to be successful, you're going to have credit collateral.
Yes, sir.
And you're going to have a name that can have other people to leverage their collateral with you.
It's
your
right.
integrity that with it. So that's kind of my thing. In the 14 years, 12 years in this thing straight, I didn't have any grants. I didn't have that. I took care of it. Me and my wife financially, keeping three transitional houses open, providing services, two child development centers, being able to do that with other things I was doing financially in real estate, consulting with treatment facilities, and keeping this open because I believe in recovery. Mm-hmm. So I believe that people need this place. So it's not only my life, because I've been in recovery myself for 20 years. So it's not only my life, but it's my way of life.
Yes.
It's like preaching, you know. Yeah. And so it's my passion that I do this to keep it open. But let me tell you, 12 of them years, it was barely meeting $50,000 a year, $60,000, $70,000.
Wow.
12 of them.
Yes, sir.
But the last 2 to 3 years is when I learned some things about 4 years ago, how to take the business to another level, learn some tools and resources to break and cross that million mark. And that was real hard and difficult. So you can be at a place 10, 12 years where you're barely making it, and then you learn some tools or resources that help you really make it.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, because I was able to make it, for an example, if I had to use a paradigm, I was able to make it on $50,000 for so long that when $500,000, $750,000, $1 million came, I'm really able to make it.
That's it.
I learned how to do it on $50,000.
That's it. That's it. Faithful over a few things.
Yes, sir. But we said 12 years strong, pouring in.
Yeah.
Managing the thing, paying utilities, paying mortgages, paying. Employees paying insurance. You got to be paid whether you make a dime or not.
That
has to be paid every month.
Right.
So you got to be creative. How do you raise money? How do you raise capital outside of the business?
That means
fundraisers, grants, loans.
For
profit. A lot of people are nonprofit when they should be for profit. You know.
Wow.
Because there's money to raise for profit if you got the right product. And you branding it right, there's people investing in things for profit. You know, Facebook is for profit. Apple is for profit.
It sure is. No joke. And they make plenty of it. You got to, and what we do, Black Press Audio Digest, is for profit. And sometimes, how do you hear, when you hear that, Sister Shannon, what do you think when you hear, he's a veteran entrepreneur, if you will, and you're as a beginner, what comes through your mind?
Oh, I think that's great advice. I'm going to go ahead and pat myself on the back a little bit because I was talking to my partner who, you know, we're looking at different loan options and different things like that. But I had that thought that, you know what, I think that I can do this and not have to take out a loan. So that was just validation of that thought I had. So thanks so much for that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, don't do the loan. Do the fundraiser. Do the family support, share your vision, put a portfolio together of what your brand is going to be, not exposing to them how to do it, but what your branding and the product and the demand that people have. And then tell them, listen, today I want you to sow into this vision I have because I want to do this starting off debt free. I know down the line I may have to make debt, but starting off, I want to start off debt free. You never know. You may raise $25,000-$50,000 capital right there that you don't have to pay back and didn't have to borrow.
Mm-hmm.
And then you keep them apprised. And when your company do make that turning curve and do begin to be a profit, and you say to them, listen, now I want you to invest in it, and now you're going to get paid something back.
Mm-hmm.
But also at the same time, you're better off doing loans with family and small groups because you can say, I can't afford to give you 10 or 12% interest. But I will give you 3% interest. You know, when we bought our third church with our ministry, I couldn't come up with all the money. I put up $120,000 that I had, and I raked the scrape to do that cash. And the members didn't give like I would have loved them to give. They didn't. But I had some members that loaned me money. I said, listen, can I give you 3% interest on your money if you will loan it to me? I promise to pay it back to you in 24 months. That's our church. It's not me. That's our church. I'm the pastor. Well, I was able to pull $27,000 out of people that way. They had it to give but didn't give it, but they had it to loan.
Right.
So they were able to do that and freely. Had I not come up with loan, that's $27,000 more I would have needed to come
up
with.
Yes, sir.
So you could do that with your small group and your family and say, listen, let me give you a promissory note of 3% on your money. And I need it for 24 months. If I can pay it back sooner, I will. 3% is still guaranteed. Them things you could do to get capital where, you know, you can go to your family and say, listen, I'm going to double up two payments on you, or you're not paying for 24 months. Mm-hmm. But with the bank, you can't tell them that. They want their money, and they start digging your credit.
That's right.
And you got that pressure. Business good in January, February, and March, the first quarter. But then you hit your worst two quarters all the way into August, and you're like, hey, I was able to pay. You can't explain that to the lender. Mm-hmm. Now they feel like your business is no good. You didn't have a good business plan. You didn't see this coming. You can never plan perfectly for that, because a perfect storm comes with your perfect plan.
That's right. That's right. Man, Wendell, we need to do this more often. I think we need to perhaps even tap into other entrepreneurs, other pastors who are doing and have some similar kinds of experiences, and perhaps even the kinds of advice that you're bringing. I think that probably the most prolific and most ingenious crowdfunding source on the planet is the African American church, and has always been. I mean, we are the most beneficent, if you will, and generous in terms of giving for particular causes for which we believe. I mean, you think of SCLC, NAACP, you think of all of our organizations, schools and colleges and HBCUs have in large measure been blessed by the largesse of crowdfunding through the Black church. That was where my dissertation was in, finding economic development through the Black church. I think, and I just believe, that without the African American church and its crowdfunding capacity, where would our community be today in terms of whatever our accomplishments and achievements have been? If you were to give any concluding advice or insight, Reverend Davis, and then Shannon. Well, let me hear from you, Shannon, first. If you were to give some other concluding advice, or just some other things to look out for and encourage entrepreneurs as they discern direction, and then you, Reverend Davis, about what you would give as some additional or concluding advice, what would that be? You first, Shannon, and then Dr. Davis.
Sure. I mean, for me, I would say follow your passion, and not just follow your passion today, but follow a passion that you really, really had, that God has truly planted in your heart, that you have no shadow of a doubt that this is something that you're on, that God has put you here for this cause. Because, I mean, I don't know about anyone else, but for me, if I don't follow my passion, then I'm one foot in, one foot out. I start the business plan, I stop, and, you know, just God has planted a lot of seeds in my heart, and I know with other people, God has planted a lot of seeds in your heart as well. But follow the one that is calling you the most, and hopefully I'll see you at the SBA.
Absolutely. All right. Dr. Davis?
What was that question again, Lauren?
Just if you had to give any other insight based on your experience and your successes, and even some of your challenges, some of your failures, if you had any other resources that you would recommend. Ms. Braxton has mentioned the SBA.
I would say be convinced yourself first. Be convinced that you can. Convince you first before you try to convince others. Develop a brand that you've developed that you can buy into. Yeah. It's your life. It's yours. It's not someone else's.
Right.
You can't explain someone else's vision of brand, because you won't have the passion of them. So it has to be yours. And oftentimes what happens is we get good ideas, but they're somebody else's, and we can't work it because we don't have a passion for it.
Wow.
So it must be yours.
Yes.
It must be your passion, because you'll live, die, sleep, eat it.
Yeah.
And then the next thing is go hard in the paint.
All right.
Go hard.
All right.
Sleep
All
on
right.
it. Go hard. Be
go
aggressive.
Hard.
Yeah. Go hard, because you can play hard and play hard long later. But right now, you know, you go hard to where ain't no play time. It's just it. I got to work. I'm on the grind. I'm grinding hard. I don't have time to sleep, eat. All I got time to think my vision and live out my vision and make it my purpose. It has to become your life, like your heart needs blood to pump, your lungs need oxygen. If you're going to be in business, this is the way it's got to go, because 2 months go by. Uh-huh. You don't have your rent and your mortgage. You didn't go hard on your business. It's nobody's fault but yours. You're sleeping and you eating, but you broke at the end of the month. you ain't doing it right with business, because you can't be broke at the end of the month. You got to get bills paid. So you got to go hard every day of the month so that in the month, the checks add up, the bills get paid, the margins get paid, the salaries get paid. And that's what people don't understand. They get lax and want to play and go in debt and want to be seen with what they're doing, when you really need to be on the grind hard working at what you're doing.
Absolutely. Man, you talk that. You talk that. I want to thank the two of you for being with me today. I especially want to applaud you, Shannon, for your courage and coming out here to Los Angeles with nothing and making something out of what you have as a passion. And for you, Dr. Davis, you looked at your employment situation and you were tired of being treated a certain way, and you didn't hate the game. You just changed yourself and changed the game. And I just think I think that's commendable. I didn't even realize that. I know we've talked a lot about the things we do with both co-founders of ministries or churches, and now, you know, I'm a entrepreneur as well. That's kind of the reason why I've been ghost a lot. I've been doing just what you just mentioned, and I'm not ashamed of it. I got to do what I got to do. I can't make all the meetings. I can't make all the conventions. I can't be in all of the circles and, you know, with everybody else. And sometimes you have to be by yourself to do what you got to do. And I have appreciated your support and your friendship and the mister. You may not have known what I was doing, but you knew I was up to something. And I'm extremely proud of you, Shannon, and Dr. Davis, for what you're doing. And I'm hoping that you continue to excel. At some point, I'm going to pull you back again so we can have some type of seminar for entrepreneurs, pastors, and lay people who want to step out on faith, who really need to, you know, just churn their passion into their pursuit. And so what I want to do now is kind of close out with my passion, which is, again, providing audio versions of Black newspapers. I have located the newest and most recent edition of the Black Press Audio Digest. It's the Charlotte Post edition. And I'm going to let my callers have a great afternoon. And I'm going to thank you so much for being online. And we'll close out at this this temporarily off edition on entrepreneurship with this Black Press Audio Digest. Y'all have a great afternoon and God bless you.
The week of May 7th through 13th, 2014. In the news,
women rule at the ballot box.
Teen birth rate falls to new low.
And more of us heading back to work.
In sports,
so many needs and options.
Golf pioneers honored on Wall of Fame.
And Mallard Creek aims for title track.
In life,
gift ideas for mom's big day.
Tight budget is no restriction on smart fashion shopping.
And spring is season for allergies and tips to alleviate symptoms.
In A&E.
On the record with Burl Cleage.
And now to the news. Presented by the magic of Macy's.
Women rule at the ballot box.
By Herbert L. White. The Charlotte Post.
Women flexed their political muscles in Charlotte's area primary races. Democrats boosted women to impressive wins in the 12th Congressional District and pulled off dominant upsets in North Carolina Senate District 40 and Mecklenburg County Commissioners at-large races, out-distancing male candidates along the way. North Carolina Rep. Alma Adams of Greensboro pulled away to an easy victory in the 12th Congressional District in two races, one to complete former Representative Mel Watts' term through the end of this year and the other for a two-year term starting next year. Adams, the only woman in the six-candidate field, cleared the 40% vote threshold to avoid a runoff, earning 43.6% of the vote for the unexpired term and 43.6% of the vote for the full term. North Carolina Senator Malcolm Graham of Charlotte finished second with 23.9% of the ballots cast. I want to go to Congress to be the voice for the working families of the 12th District, and I'll be working every single day from now until November 4th to make sure that all we've accomplished thus far does not go to waste, Adams said in a statement. In Mecklenburg, former Charlotte City Council member Ella Scarsborough finished first in the Democratic at-large race, marking a comeback from more than a decade away from elected office. Incumbent freshmen Pat Cotham and Trevor Fuller finished second and third, respectively, briefly, but incumbent Kim Ratliff finished last in the five-candidate field. Charlotte-Mecklenburg School Board member Joyce Waddell earned the Democratic nomination for State Senate District 40 with a convincing win against a field of four men that included former City Council member Nastif Majid. Waddell will replace Graham, who vacated the seat to run for Congress.
The news continues with Teen Birth Rate Falls to New Low by Herbert L. White, The Charlotte Post.
U.S. teen pregnancy, birth, and abortion rates have fallen drastically from 20 years ago, a study finds. The survey by the Guttmacher Institute showed a steep decline in pregnancy since their peak in the early 1990s. In 2010, 614,000 pregnancies occurred among teenage girls aged 15 to 19 for a rate of 57.4 per 1,000, a 51% slide from the 1990 peak. The 2010 rate represents a 15% drop in just 2 years from the 2008 rate of 67.8 pregnancies per 1,000 girls, according to U.S. Teen Pregnancy, Birth, and Abortions 2010, National and State Trends by Age, Race, and Ethnicity. North Carolina ranked 20th nationally with 59 teen pregnancies per 1,000 in 2010, 17th in birth rate, 38 per 1,000, and 22nd in birth rate at 12 per 1,000 teens. Among ethnic groups, the pregnancy rate was 87 per 1,000 among black teens in North Carolina, 8,010 total, beating the national average of 99.5 in 2010. The rate among Hispanics was 100 per 1,000, 2,970 total, and 40 per 1,000 for whites, 7,560 total. The black birth rate in North Carolina was 51 per 1,000 girls, compared to 28 for whites and 70 for Hispanics. Nationally, the teen birth rate declined 44% from the 1991 peak, from 61.8 births per 1,000 to 34.4 per 1,000. And the teen abortion rate fell 66% between its 1988 peak and 2010, from 43.5 abortions per 1,000 to 14.7 per 1,000. While there was a drop in pregnancy rate for 15 to 17-year-olds and 18 to 19-year-olds between 2008 and 10, pregnancies among 18 and 19-year-olds made up 69% of teen pregnancies. The study also found dramatic nationally declines in teen pregnancy rates among all racial and ethnic groups, although disparities still exist. To read the full story, visit thecharlottepost.com.
Also in the news,
More of Us Heading Back to Work
by Freddie Allen, National Newspaper Publishers Association.
The black unemployment rate fell to 11.6% in April, the lowest mark since President Barack Obama took office in January 2009, according to the Labor Department.
I was born by the river in a little tent. Oh, and just like the river, I've been running ever since. It's been a long